Everybody, it's great to have you on tuning in tonight to the gospel service in the People's Church Newton Abbey. I hope you've had a good Pentecost Sunday today. As you know, it's Pentecost, 50 days after the cross where Jesus died for our sins and was buried and gloriously raised from the dead. He's alive tonight, but 50 days later is the day of Pentecost, and it's the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So we're going to read tonight from the scriptures, two scriptures, John chapter 20, verse 19, and Acts chapter 2. So let's read John 20, verse 19. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. They were together and they were together. They were together in one place, but they were also together in one spirit. They were together in unity. That's what prayer does. Prayer brings believers together in one place and together in unity. Now notice what happened when they were together in one place and in unity. Notice, and suddenly, not immediately, because they had been with Jesus for 40 days, and now they were praying 10 days together, getting themselves sorted out, waiting on the Lord and waiting for the promise of the Father. So notice, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them divided or cloven tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused, because everyone heard them speak in his own language. And in verse 11, we hear what they were saying. We hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God. So they were all amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, whatever could this mean? Others mocking said, they are full of new wine. You always get the critic. If you're going to do anything for God, you'll be criticized. So don't let the critic put you off. Others said they were full of new wine. They were drunk. But listen to this, verse 14. But Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and heed my words, for these are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day, 9 o'clock in the morning. But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And so Peter then begins to preach the gospel. And he ends with this verse, verse 36. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you have crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. They were convicted of their sin and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promises to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call. Now listen to this. And with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse or crooked generation. And watch their response. Then those who gladly received his word, they didn't do it under duress. They weren't forced. They gladly received his word. That's the gospel. Those who gladly received his word were baptized. And that day, about 3,000 souls were added to them. A brilliant chapter, the birth of the early church. But I want you to notice two verses there. Verse 19 in John chapter 20. The doors being shut for fear of the Jews. Acts chapter 2 verse 4. Then they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. I want you to notice two contrasting extremes here. Paralyzing fear and powerful faith. Paralyzing fear and powerful faith. Fear, timidity, and perplexity were defeated that day by boldness, courage, and bravery. From fearfulness to fearlessness. The ironic thing is, these two verses, it's the same people in both verses. Yet the first is so dramatically different than the second. What made the difference? Answer: the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of Pentecost in those believers' lives. Doors being shut for fear of the Jews, they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Brother and sister, the difference was the power of the Holy Spirit. Here the disciples are huddled together in the upper room like frightened chickens. Doors are shut, closed, bolted. Fear had paralyzed them. Outside those doors was a hostile world, a society calling for more blood that already crucified their master and their Lord, and an adverse community. They were looking more blood. And to venture out would mean certain persecution or suffering or death, more crosses carrying Christians, followers of the crucified one. So they took to hiding in that upper room. Fear of the Jews. Notice, fear of the Jews had hemmed them in. I want to ask you a question. Are you hiding your faith, your love for Jesus? Are you living in fear? Are you a Christian but can't face people for fear of repercussion or hostility or rejection? Is fear paralyzing your faith? Then you'll know how the disciples felt in that upper room. Aye, but I've got good news for you. Jesus stepped in. Whether the doors were bolted or shut or not, they don't hold the risen Christ back. Jesus appeared to these paralyzed disciples, giving them, listen, his peace, peace be unto you, alleviating their fears. His presence, he inspired them by showing his hands and his side. It was him. It was the resurrected Lord. And then he gave them his promise. He was motivating their faith. Listen, you're going to have the Holy Spirit, but you have to wait for it. And then he said, you're going to receive power, his power, empowering them to become worshippers, witnesses, winners, and workers together for the gospel. But they had to wait for it. He said, tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. So he told them to wait until. So they waited and they prayed and they waited and they prayed and they waited and they prayed for the next 10 days after his ascension. And then on the day of Pentecost, the 50th day, then something supernatural happened. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, listen, they were all together in one place, in one accord. We have to be together, and we have to be together. We have to be in one place, and we have to be in one accord, in unity. That's where the Lord commands a blessing. Because when that happened on the 50th day, listen to what it says. Suddenly, there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Listen. And then tongues of fire, clothed in tongues of fire, sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them the utterance. Notice, the Holy Spirit filled that upper room and everyone in it. Nobody was left out. Every believer needs filled with the Holy Spirit. He didn't leave anybody. He didn't exclude anybody. There was nobody better than anybody else. There was nobody less than anyone else. He filled the room and everyone in it. The Holy Spirit came upon them, filled them, empowered them, and overflowed from them in worship. It released them from their fears, inspired them to worship the Lord personally and publicly. Their worship actually was not contained in that upper room. They were so full of the Holy Spirit that their worship spilled out onto the streets of Jerusalem. Their worship became attractive. Brother and sister, is your worship attractive? Is our worship attractive? Is it winsome? Brothers and sisters, is it pleasant to the ear? And is it pleasant to the eye? Brother and sister, because this worship in the early church, these believers were full of the Holy Spirit, and their worship was attractive. It drew a crowd. It drew a crowd of anxious inquirers, and their worship was attractive. The crowd gathered. Some said they were drunk. Others didn't know what was going on. But Peter stood up and began to preach. Hold on a minute. Peter? I was talking about Peter, the failure, Peter, the denier, Peter, the coward, Peter, the swerve. Yes, The same man, Peter, the failure, he, brother and sister, is filled with the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. Jesus rescued this failure. Do you hear me? I hope there's a failure listening to this message. Jesus rescued this failure and he restored him. He forgave him and he also began to fill him with his Holy Spirit and released him to preach the gospel to these people who were watching and listening to these 120 believers worshiping in spirit and in truth. Brother and sister, are you a worshiper? Well, hold on. Are you filled with the Holy Spirit? Do you know Jesus? And are you filled with his Holy Spirit? And are you worshiping him in spirit and in truth? Come on, let's do that tonight in the name of Jesus. But notice, his peace overcame their fears. His presence overcame their doubts. His promise overcame their apprehensions. And his power overcame their inhibitions. From that upper room, the power of God took those paralyzed disciples, somebody said wimps, listen, anointed them, filled them, and empowered them to become bold as lions. Notice, frightened chickens are now fearless lions. Brother and sister, bold as lions in the face of adversity, hostility, danger, aye, and even death. From fearfulness to fearlessness. Brother and sister, have you had the change? Has he transformed you from being fear-filled to being fearless? I tell you tonight, let the Holy Spirit fill us with that fearlessness in these fearful days. We're living in fearful days. Listen, Project Fear is paralyzing the world. It's disgusting. It's terrible. Brother and sister, he whom the Son sets free shall be free indeed. We're not to give in and be paralyzed and crippled and silenced by fear. We're here to do a job, and our job is to preach the gospel to every creature. We're to go into all the world and preach the gospel to everyone we meet, making disciples of them. Brother and sister, this is not the time to be afraid. On the day of Pentecost, a defeated church in that upper room became a victorious church out on the streets of Jerusalem. A church triumphant, preaching the greatest news in the world, the gospel. Brother and sister, that frightened group of 120 believers, when empowered by the Holy Spirit of God on Pentecost, became bold as lions. Their faith was no longer private, but public. And they began to worship. Their worship spilled out onto the streets. And brother and sister, they had an open air. And their open air gathered the crowd. And the crowd were investigating and anxiously asking, what's going on here? Some said they were drunk. And brother, you'll always get it. They said they were drunk. But Peter stands up. Peter the failure is now Peter, the Holy Ghost empowered preacher. Brother and sister, if you're going to preach, ask the Holy Spirit to deliver you from all your fears. The fear of people, the fear of what others think, the fear of being rejected. Listen, you're not called to do all that. You're called to preach, brother. So just preach. But before you get into the pulpit, before you stand up to say anything, get filled with the Holy Ghost. Ask the Lord to fill you. In the early church, every one of them was filled. And by the way, every one of them was at that open air. Every one of them was filled with the Holy Spirit, and every one of them was in the open air worshiping the Lord. Why? God brought them from the upper room out into the open air, out into the public, from fear to faith. Brother and sister, will you allow the Holy Spirit to make you a worshiper, no matter who's watching you? Would you let the Holy Spirit fill you to overflowing, that you just worship the King and you don't care what anybody thinks? Would you let him also make you a witness to the lost, starting in your own home? Remember, You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me. Listen, in Jerusalem, that's your home. In Judea, that's across the street. In Samaria, that's across the boundaries, and into the uttermost parts of the world. So we are to be witnesses. But in order to be effective, we need to be filled. Listen, the early church was a spirit-filled church. It was a praying church, because they were praying for 10 days solid in that upper room. It was a spirit-filled church, but it was also a witnessing church and a worshiping church. They worshiped the Lord in the spirit, and they witnessed to the lost with the gospel. And then they fellowshiped together. Now listen, can I say this to you, brother? You and I weren't saved from a lost eternity to hide in an upper room behind closed doors. You weren't redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ's precious blood, to sit on the mantelpiece as an ornament. You weren't called to compromise what you believe in Jesus, but to make disciples for Jesus. You weren't conscripted into a defeated army, but an army of victorious overcomers for Christ. So come on, brother, sister, People's Church, Newton Abbey, brother and sister from another church, if you're listening, listen well, because listen, this message is for me, but it's also for you if you're listening. Do something about it after you hear this message. You weren't saved to sit in the house, petrified by fear. You weren't saved to cringe and shiver, frightened of people. You weren't saved to be timid and helpless and spineless, the spineless disciple. No way. Who wants to be that? I don't want to be part of a church like that. That's a flimsy, watered down church. No, we're a church triumphant. Jesus Christ died for us on the cross to forgive us of our sins and to wash us from our past. But he also wants to fill us. He rose from the dead. That resurrection power wants to live inside us. And listen, we need the power of the Holy Spirit. We need the power of Pentecost to empower us and equip us to witness and to worship first the Lord in spirit and in truth. And secondly, to witness and then to win the lost in the name of Jesus. Can I tell you something? There's no way I want to be a whimsy, compromising, defeated, flaky church. No, we are to be loyal, powerful ambassadors of a glorious Lord, a risen Lord. Listen, obedient soldiers of a victorious captain, and sons and daughters of a gracious Father. That day, the Holy Spirit took these frightened, petrified disciples, frightened chickens, out of their prison cell of fear, under the center stage, under the spotlight, into the limelight. There was nowhere to hide any longer. They were all together, worshiping together, and witnessing to approximately 1 to 2 million people in the city of Jerusalem. He came up for the Feast of Pentecost. Brother and sister, onto that stage, God bursts his church and births his church. In fact, they were not allowed to hide any longer. They didn't want to hide. That's the difference. When you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you don't want to hide. You want the world to know that you love Jesus and you're serving the King. Brothers and sisters, they didn't want to hide any longer. There was no desire to hide, for they were given a power, a boldness, a purpose, and a divine commission. You shall receive power. They received it to be witness unto me, and they became witnesses. Brother, sister, listen to what the reaction was. When they heard them speaking on their own tongues, they said, the wonderful works of God. That's what the crowd said. We're hearing them speaking. Here's Galileans, and they're speaking in foreign languages. That's called the tongues of men. Now, there's the tongues, the unknown tongue, and there's the tongues of angels. If you want to read Paul's epistle to the, or Corinthians, letter to the Corinthians. But brothers and sisters, listen, they said, we heard them speaking in our own tongues, the wonderful works of God. Some thought they were drunk, but Peter stands up. Peter the failure is now Peter the winner, filled with the Holy Spirit. And listen, when he preaches, brother and sister, he says, this is not, they're not drunk. This is what was prophesied of. This is a prophecy fulfilled in Joel chapter 2, verse 28. In the last days, I'll pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And he's saying that, and he's telling them what happened. And then he preaches from this, he brings in the Lord Jesus, his death and resurrection and the gospel. Now listen to what it says in verse 36. Are you ready for this? It says in verse 36, "Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ." Now when they heard this, brother and sister, Peter the failure, Peter the coward, Peter the denier, is now Peter the forgiven, the restored, and the empowered. Listen, failing brother, failure brother, sister, if you've let the Lord down, maybe you've denied him, maybe even with curses and swears, maybe you've run away in shame and you've hidden your face in disgrace, stop everything. Because listen, if he can restore Peter, if he can forgive Peter, and if he can empower Peter with the same Holy Spirit, then he can do the same for you. Come on, stop wallowing in your failures. Stop wallowing in disgrace. He wants to restore you, forgive you, and empower you. Will you let him tonight? Will you let him empower you? Because Peter stood up and he began to preach the gospel. Brother and sister, we need spirit-filled preachers of the gospel in our churches tonight, all over the land and the nation. Now here he is. Here's the one who failed. Now he's preaching the gospel unashamedly. And he's preaching it under the power of the Holy Spirit. He's preaching Jesus Christ and him crucified, whom God has made Lord and Christ. That's the power of the gospel. Brother and sister, the one who died on the cross, God allowed his son to die for your sins and mine. Do you hear that, friend? Jesus Christ died for you. He loved you enough to die for you. He took your sins on his own body. You have just to confess your sins and ask him to forgive you and turn away. Don't be doing the same things over again. Turn away from your sinful life and your sins, and he'll forgive you, and he'll wash you clean, and he'll give you a new life. And he, not only that, he'll give you power to live it. The power of the Holy Spirit. When he preached the gospel, these people were convicted. They were pricked in their hearts. Their conscience troubled them. They realized they were sinners, going to a lost eternity, and they had just crucified Jesus Christ, God's Son. When they heard this, they were convicted. Brother and sister, friend, do you know what conviction is? You can't sleep at night. You can't rest because your sins are before your face, and you're frightened to die because you haven't been forgiven. They were guilty and they knew it. They were convicted and they needed to do something. Are you convicted by your sins tonight? Have you crucified Jesus every day in your life? Every time you say no to Jesus, you're crucifying him again and again. They were convicted of their sin. They had crucified Christ. But do you know what they did? They cried out. They cried out. He's still waiting to hear your cry, friend. He's still waiting to hear you crying. What they said, man, brethren, Pastor George, Pastor Tommy, Pastor John, what shall we do? That's what they said. They heard the gospel and then they were anxious inquirers because convicted of their sin. And they asked the question, what must we do? What shall we do? And Peter told them what to do. I want to tell you something, brother, sister. If someone says, what must I do? You need to know how to tell them the gospel. Keep it simple. Here's the gospel in a nutshell. You ready? Peter said to them, repent, and every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, and you for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Notice the word repent. Repent means about turn. You can't accept Jesus and still sin. You can't accept Jesus and still walk your old haunts and do your old same things, all the things that you know are wrong before God. Listen, you have to do an about turn. You have to walk, turn around from the road to destruction and step onto the road, the narrow road that leads to life. That's repentance, 180 degrees, about turn. They repented. He said, repent. Listen, repent, every one of you. Let me just read it again to you. Peter said, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, there's no difference here. Every one of us had to do this. You have to repent of your sins and accept Jesus as your Savior. Have you done that yet? Christian, have you done that yet? You're professing. Have you turned away from your sins? Have you asked him to forgive you and to cleanse you and to break every chain so that you're going to about turn and follow the narrow road to the kingdom of heaven? Remember, repent. Turn from your sin. Be sorry for your sin. Ask God to forgive your sin. And put your trust in the one who died for your sin and rose again the third day. Jesus Christ, the Savior. The only Savior. The only way, truth and life. He is. Aye. And be baptized. Now that doesn't mean sprinkled or christened. This is not child sprinkling. No. This is believer's baptism. In other words, publicly demonstrate your love and devotion in following Jesus, that you're his disciple, by publicly going under the waters, you're burying the old you, and you're rising up to walk in newness of life. You're burying the old, it's the funeral service of the old you, and it's the resurrection service of the new. That's what believer's baptism is, and it's in the name of Jesus Christ. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So there's forgiveness there, and there's the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now notice their response, brother and sister. Listen, friend, listen to the response to the gospel. And I'm praying tonight that you will respond to the gospel listening to this message. That you'll just not listen and say, oh, that was lovely. Get up and walk out and go back to the same things you've been doing for all your life. No, I'm praying that God the Holy Ghost will stop you in your tracks. Convict you as he did with these people, and that you will be converted to Christ from tonight, that you'll not live the same way anymore, but you'll live for Jesus. Now notice what their response was. Verse 41, then those who gladly received his word, that's the gospel, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent the Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world may be saved through him. Jesus was sent into this world to take your sin, but to save you from your sins as well. So may the Lord Jesus speak to you tonight. If you're here and you're listening in front of this TV set or phone or tablet and you're watching this service, I want to encourage you, let the Holy Spirit convict you of the sins in your life, that you will want inside here to repent of your sin and put your trust in Jesus Christ. Now notice then, those who gladly received his word, the gospel, were baptized. In other words, they received what they were listening to. They believed it. They accepted it. They put their trust in Jesus. They turned away from their sins. And to show it, they publicly were baptized. Now listen, there was 1 to 2 million people in Jerusalem, all Jews, Gentiles coming in, yes, Jews and Romans, but they were all there. And these 120 people who were filled with the Holy Spirit came out into the street to worship. They attracted this crowd, many, many thousands. And out of it, 3,000 of those anxious inquirers publicly and personally accepted Jesus, turned from their sin, and to show it, they were publicly baptized in water. They buried the old and they rose up in the new. That's what we need to do in the 21st century. That's what we need to do in our day and generation. And that day, about 3,000 souls were added to them. The 120 in the early church grew by 3,000 in one day. 3,120, 3,000 new converts, 3,000 new lambs, 3,000 new births. The early church was birthed in an explosive, suddenly a rushing mighty wind. the gospel, the filling, the gospel, the salvation. And now they're all together and they're serving God together. The power of the Holy Ghost. Can I tell you something? It's needed again tonight. We need the power of the Holy Ghost in the church again tonight. And it's not just shivers up and down your spine. No. It's not just a wee flutter here or a wee oh, whatever. No, brother and sister, we need the power of the Holy Ghost in our worship, in our witness, in winning the lost, aye, and in working together in the Spirit. Brother and sister, we need another Pentecost. I believe that's why the witness of many professing Christians is weak and watery, ineffective and unconvincing, because they haven't taken hold of the passion of Christ, the peace of Christ, the promise of Christ, and they haven't experienced the power of Christ. Somewhere between Calvary and Pentecost, they're stuck. They're stuck in a rut. They're paralyzed. They're incarcerated in their prison of fear, timidity, anxiety, and perplexity. And they need the doors opened again. They need Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit. Sadly, their doors aren't only shut for fear of people, but they're bolted and they're keeping themselves locked in from living outside for God. God doesn't want his children living behind closed doors. Did you hear that, secret disciple? Come on, that's Pentecost today. We're celebrating the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. You can't celebrate it in private. Get out there and witness for Jesus. God doesn't want his children hiding behind closed doors. Christ doesn't want his church to live defeated, demoralized lives. The Holy Spirit doesn't want to anoint you for you to sit in a wee holy huddle singing choruses. No way. Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Listen, Jesus wants to empower your life. Jesus wants to fill you with the Holy Spirit. That power can transform your life. That power, are you listening, can save and forgive you from your sins. That power that his blood that was shed on the cross, his power can save you from the penalty of your sins. Your sins are taking you to a lost eternity if they're not forgiven. We've all sinned, so you're not on your own. We've all done it. But we have called upon the Lord. We have confessed our sins, and he has faithfully forgive us of our sins and cleansed us from all unrighteousness. So you need to confess your sins to him, not the priest, not the pastor. You need to confess your sins to the great high priest, Jesus. And he'll forgive you. Listen, and he'll release you, secondly. He'll not only forgive you of your sins, he'll release you from the power of your sins, those habits in your life. He'll break the chains. And thirdly, he will empower you to be an effective worshipper and witness in this world that you're surrounded in. Brother and sister, Peter stood up and he preached. The early church went out and worshipped and witnessed. God made them salt and light and ambassadors. Simple people. Simple people filled with the Holy Spirit turned their world upside down in the space of 40 years. Church, people's church, in this day of fear, in these days of anxiety, don't lose your faith. Ask the Lord to fill you with the Holy Spirit. Aye, and read this book. You need to keep reading the Word. The wee text for the day is good, but you need to read the Word. Peter preached the Word, the Gospel. And listen, those 3,000 people, when they got saved, they went on. Listen to what they did. Listen to this. Then they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and breaking of bread and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Notice, they didn't get saved and stayed where they were. No, they continued steadfastly. Another translation says they devoted themselves. Listen, what to? The apostles' doctrine, this book. The Word of God. Listen, fellowship. Fellowshipping together. Reaching out, bringing other people with you. breaking of bread, remembering what he did. Every time we gather together on a Sunday morning, we break bread. Short accounts with God, we remember what he did. They broke bread together. Yes, and in prayers. The prayer meeting was the powerhouse. You hear me saying it? I'm not stopping it, because you're going to hear about it tomorrow night. It's Pentecost, and you're going to hear it's only a prayer meeting. That's what's been said over the act. It's only the prayer meeting. Well, tomorrow night you're going to hear about it's only the prayer meeting and what happened in the prayer meeting and what happens in prayer meetings when the Holy Ghost shows up. So brother and sister, they continued steadfastly. They devoted themselves to the apostles' doctrine, the word of God, and fellowship as well, reaching out to each other, breaking the bread, remembrance, and also prayers, the prayer meeting. So I want to encourage you, there's a going on. But listen, God, and I'm praying this tonight, God, we need another Pentecost. We need Holy Ghost worship from the Spirit and in truth. We need a Holy Ghost witness that will attract and arrest people to listen to the Word of God, the Gospel. We need Holy Ghost preaching that when people hear it, they're convicted of their sin. We need Holy Ghost conviction of sin in the church and also at open hours. We need Holy Ghost conversion that when the Holy Ghost stops you in your tracks, you can't do nothing but say, what must I do? Oh God, send us a Holy Ghost conversion. Even this weekend, we need Holy Ghost adding. The Lord added to the church daily, such as who were being saved. And that's what we need. We need a revival in the church. We need salvation in the province and in the nation. We need healing, and we need the power of the Holy Ghost back again among his people. Church, I want to ask you a question. Brother, how's your worship? No, hold on, let me just start. How's your prayer life? How's your prayer life? Is it dead or dying, or is it alive and thriving? How's your worship? How's your worship? Is it attractive, or is it off-putting? Is it winsome, or is it deadly? How's your witness? Are you being an effective witness? Is it wonderful? Is it attractive? Is it inspiring? Or is it disgusting? Brother and sister, how's your witness? Do they see you talking about or hear they talking about Jesus and then going and getting drunk? Do they hear you talking about being saved and you're reeking of cigarette smoke? Are you telling them that they need to turn from their sins and you're living in sin? Because listen, it doesn't work. People will see through you that you're false and you're a fake. Don't be a fake. Be real. Be a genuine believer. And ask the Lord to help you. Ask him to fill you with the Holy Spirit. Ask him to fill your worship with his presence. Ask him to fill your witness with effectiveness. And give him your life. Let him do something in your life tonight. Let him use you for the extension of his kingdom and the glory of his name. Friend, you and I need this Pentecostal power. People's Church need nobody. We need that Pentecostal power. We need it. Christian, you need filled. You need baptized in the Holy Spirit. Aye, and water if you haven't been yet. We need Holy Ghost passion in the church today. Not formality, pomp, and programs. No, programs don't win people. Pomp doesn't attract people, but the truth does. And it's when it's preached in the power of the Spirit. Maybe you're here tonight or listening tonight and you're not a Christian. Come on, let's pray. Friend, if you're not saved and you want to be saved, pray this prayer with me. If you're a backslider, you pray it too. And if you're out of sorts and you don't know where you are, you pray too. Let's pray together. Father, I come to you in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus, the one who died on the cross for me. Lord, will you forgive me of my sins tonight? Would you come into my heart? Would you wash me clean from the inside out in your precious blood? Lord, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come in today. Come in and stay. Change my life, Lord. And Lord, I turn away from my past and I want to follow Jesus for the rest of my days. Hear my cry, Lord. Save me. Restore me. Revive me. Whatever I need, Lord, would you meet my need? And Lord, I will follow you for the rest of my days. I pray, Lord Jesus, give me the courage to tell my friends and family I've surrendered my life to Jesus. So I ask these things in the precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you prayed that prayer, friend, just lift the phone. We'd like to hear from you. I want to encourage you. Pray with you personally over the phone if we can. But we're here for your help. I also want to thank the People's Church for your texts, your emails, your WhatsApps, for all your support. It is truly appreciated. And by the way, thank you for your generous giving and your tithes and offerings and also your donations and gifts. Thank you so much. It truly is appreciated from myself and also the other pastors. So we want to thank you for your giving and keep at it. And the Lord bless you. I also want to pray just a blessing on the Word of God tonight. Just feel I want to pray a blessing. I also want to thank God for Eileen Gordon. It was a privilege and a pleasure to lead her to Jesus on Friday. And you're going to hear a song in a minute. It's called A New Name Written Down in Glory. And it's mine. Well, for Eileen, it's yours. A New Name Written Down in Glory. And it's mine. Oh, may the angels rejoice with us as we rejoice with Eileen and Charlie for his wife's salvation. But also remember, because she's not too well at this time as well, and we're trusting the Lord just to be with her. But she's ready. She knows Jesus. Praise the Lord. Father, we pray, Lord, that you'll bless your word tonight. Let your word touch our hearts. Let your word prick our consciences. Let your word convict us of our sins. And let your word draw us to Jesus. Father, help us, Lord. Lord, may someone come to know Jesus tonight. May someone come back to the Lord tonight. May someone get out of their rut tonight and start serving Jesus and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Thank you for Eileen, giving her life to Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for that God moment, Lord. We just praise you for it, Lord. And we say, to God be the glory. Bless her and bless Charlie. And you know, Eileen's not too well. Just bless her, Father. In the precious name of Jesus. Hear our prayers tonight because we ask it in the lovely name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Keep on going on. See you tomorrow night at the prayer meeting. Oh, I was lost in shame, could not get past my blame, till he called my name. I'm so glad he saved me, doctors held me down, Jesus pulled me out, I'm no longer bound. I'm so glad he changed me, God. Oh,
Israel.